I would say music chose me initially, because my father and mother tell me that I started playing at the age of 3, 3 and a half on the tabla, a memory of which obviously I don't have. But I have memory of my father teaching me at the age of 4, 4 and a half. And music was in my house. My father, Pandit Dinkar Kaikini, was a renowned vocalist. So was my mother, Shashikala Kaikini. She was a fantastic vocalist, but she sacrificed her life for us. So whatever I am today is because of my mother and my father. And so growing up in that atmosphere, I would say music definitely chose me first. But the decision to carry on with it later on as a career, in the most difficult times and situations, that decision was mine. But it was supported by my parents. So, you know, as a child, when I used to wake up early morning, my father would be practicing, and my mother would be teaching students, playing theka on the dagga. And so these scenes from my childhood are unforgettable. So they are my priceless memories. So I think in that way music was in me, and it was just a process of discovering it and making it a very, very serious path in terms of pursuing it for life. So that decision was mine. I think in the art there is no limits towards discovering and learning. However, after my experience with Ustad Alla Rakha Khan Sahab, my guru, mentor, my guide, my everything, after he left in 2000, after he passed on, it's been almost 20 years now. So it's been a very exciting, interesting journey, as well as at the same time very challenging, I must say, because after his departure, it was not easy to figure things out by myself in terms of learning from those people whom I have looked up to since my childhood, but not actually gone and taken training directly. Being influenced by so many different, so much music of other traditions, that has had an impact. My senior most guru bhai, and like my guru Ustad Zakir Hussain, I mean, he's been a guiding force and inspiration right from childhood. So I've been learning and trying to absorb as much as possible. But in the initial years after my Ustad passed away, it was not easy for me for a period of time to get my bearings, because I was so used to his presence around. My time with him, almost 24 years, spending easily anywhere between 48 to maybe 150 hours a week, from my childhood. There was a period where I really felt the void. And I think it's his teachings, his inspiration, his blessings that took me ahead in my journey to figure out and to try and learn more, to discover more. And I must say that many, many people, senior musicians, tabla players, great traditions across the world where I got to travel, taught me a lot in terms of developing my own music and trying to create my own sound and my own identity in terms of performance. All of that has helped me a great deal. Teaching the next generation, which I've been doing for the last 25 years pretty seriously, that gave me a deeper insight into the intellectuality of this art form. Because when you sit down and look at training someone's mind, it in turn teaches you, takes you deeper into the subject to not only transmit the information, but transmit the information to the strength of that student. What are his strengths? What are his weaknesses? So you are trying to, you know, enhance his strength and improve his weaknesses. And when you are doing that with various disciples at different levels, you know, you end up learning so much. I became a good teacher. I mean, evolved teacher. I evolved as a performer just by being in this process, trying to connect with my Ustad's energy, which I still try to do today, how he taught me and what I went through in that process with him. And all those experiences, I try to relive them with my students. So yeah, I guess it's a combination of various factors. I remember my guru telling me that, you know, if you are a student, if you remain a student all your life, you know, you'll always learn. The day you think that you've reached a certain pedestal and you are satisfied with it, you know, you stop learning. So that is a huge huge education in itself for me from my Ustad, to always keep that humility inside me, that there's always everything to learn, always everything to gain and nothing to lose. If you think that you've reached a certain pedestal and you're satisfied, you have everything to lose from that day onwards. With that philosophy, I carried on, and this art itself taught me Vidya, as we say. Vidya is supreme, knowledge is supreme, and it keeps you humble always, because whenever you think you achieved something, you know, whenever you think you just managed to cross the ocean, and then you see that the horizon is still far away, you know, you never reach the horizon. So Vidya is like that, and especially Indian art music, Rag Sangeet, Tal Sangeet, this is something which is never ending. There is always something to learn, something to discover every day. And that's the state I saw my Ustad in, because every time I went to him, he never taught me the same thing. And I used to wonder, without a book, without anything written down, without any notation, just by word of mouth, he taught me for 24 years. So when I look back, it's mind-boggling that a musical mind who is constantly trying to create, who's constantly trying to discover, to innovate, can come out with so much that today his contribution to tabla and his contribution to the Punjab gharana is priceless. It's got so much value. Watching him in that state of sadhana, watching him in that state of completely losing himself to the art form, something that taught me that this is a never-ending process. A learning is never-ending process. Knowledge is supreme. And if you have the sense of surrender and dedication to that knowledge, you will learn every day. So I still learn every day. I still feel that I still know what I don't know. I feel that every day. So whenever I sit with my instrument and try to, try to think of creating something with a new thought process, I know that I don't know how to go about this, so I need to figure it out. And that's what keeps me in the hunt for trying to, you know, pursue my Ustad's path. I trained with my father for a few years in vocal music, and that enhanced my perspective to tabla as an art form majorly. Both are abstract art forms. The only advantage that vocal music has is that when you are singing khayal, you have words to express yourself. Whereas in tabla, you don't have a meaningful language in the sense, it's an abstract language. So I would say when I really got into the thick of things in terms of talim and trying to perfect things and, you know, mature, as I was maturing, I realized that I'm actually dealing with an abstract language from which I need to express myself. It's a meaningless language. And so, what came in handy at that time was my knowledge of khayal music. That helped me immensely. Khayal development helped me, the concepts of khayal development helped me immensely in looking at observing, learning, and then looking at dimensions of exploring peshkar. Because peshkar is nothing but exploring basic phrases coming out of the theka, and then developing it and giving it a picture, try to explore it in so many other dimensions which I learned from Abbaji. So that helped me a great deal. But before that, the solidity of Vilambit Lai is something which I got from playing with khayal and learning khayal music. Then improvisation techniques through khayal that I could relate to while learning, studying and creating peshkar. That helped me a great deal. Just generally being in sur, in the sense, because you have only one note on the tabla. So, in what ways I can use the sur of the tabla, you know, the maidan sound versus and the kinar sound and the sur of the bayan in peshkar, in kaida, or in fixed compositions. And what are those, you know, minute dimensions with which I can enhance my performance with just sur? Because without sur, tabla is meaningless. I realized that tabla is basically nothing but poetry created from khali bhari. If you look at it, closed strokes versus open strokes. It's just an interrelation of closed and open strokes, which is khali bhari. But what that khali bhari is and how it is arranged and how it is used and what is the thought behind it, all these things came to my mind because I could dwell deeper into this subject because I had the background of khayal. Because khayal is also trying to establish a thought inside the time cycle, using words. So here I was, you know, when I decided to take tabla very seriously through my talim years with Abbaji, observing his peshkar, which was never the same. And it used to intrigue me that how does he play a peshkar which is different every single time? What is the thought process behind it? And how does he go about it? And so things like that. Knowledge of vocal music, khayal sangeet gave me a tremendous amount of, it was like a launching pad for me to launch myself into a further more abstract world of tabla. There was one thing that I realized accompanying vocal music, not only my father, who was a great singer, a very deep, a very highly intellectually evolved vocalist, but Even his guru wise, Pandit K.G. Ginde, the great Gwalior, great Raja Bhaiya Poonchwale, Bala Sahib Poonchwale, Sharad Chandra, Pandit Sharad Chandra Arolkar, I mean, all these huge names. Then now Pandit Ullas Kashalkar, Pandit Ajay Chakravarti. So I played with vocal music before I actually started playing with instrumental and playing tabla solo seriously. I played only with vocal music for 16 years. And of course, I had learnt vocal music. I had learnt khyal, theka, bandesh, badhat, all these things I knew. But beyond this, the gist of what it was, I discovered during so many performances with great vocalists, including my father, was that you have something very concrete in front of you. From that, you gradually lift yourself into the abstract, which is, you know, the Murt Swarup, which is Khyal, Theka, words. Everything is Murt Swarup. From that, when you start the elaboration, you slowly, gradually, aesthetically disconnect yourself and go into the abstract, which is the Amurta Swarup, right? So, I used to wonder, this kind of highly intellectual and highly creative, something which is not written down, something which is not read off books or notation or script or anything like that, which I knew. There are many things which we know in day-to-day life, but when you actually sit down and think about it seriously, it hits you one fine day. So it actually hit me one fine day that, you know, there is so much concrete that we learn in terms of knowledge, but then the true picture of the art is in the abstract and not the concrete. The highest creation, the highest picture of creation is in the abstract, it's not in the concrete. And so, most of these greats whom I saw creating this picture, so this was the gist of what I learned from these guys. And, you know, and therefore, it dawned upon me one day that if these people have to be in this state of mind, then obviously it's an inward journey. It's Atmaranjan, not Manoranjan. Right? I saw my Ustad like that. I saw my father, I saw Pandit K.G. Ginde, I saw Bala Sahib Poonchwale, I saw Arulkar Bua. I even seen Gajanan Bua Joshi from close quarters, Pandit Ullas Kashalkar Ji's guru. So I've seen so many great, you know, towering, knowledgeable people in the field of vocal music in Maharashtra. And they were all very simple. They didn't know, they had no, basically they were involved in their process of going deeper and deeper and into this art form with such intensity that they had no time to see whether the cameras were on them or not, whether, you know, their whether the reporters are trying to report something good about them in papers or not. So it was that era, you know, where it was the era of simplicity, but great people who lived simple lives, who practiced music for simply for the sake of wanting to know what this art form is about to the maximum possible level in this lifetime, in the lifetime that they lived, in the lives that they lived. And so I was fortunate to see that. I consider myself incredibly fortunate to see that state of mind and existence of such great people. So it was a huge lesson for me in many ways. But if I look at performing this art form, then that is one thing that always stood out, was the way they used to move into the abstract from the concrete and then come back to the concrete before they finished their performance. And that's what had a huge impact on the audiences as well. My personal feeling is that a rag for a khyaliya, for a khyal singer, again, he knows the rag, he knows the bandish. Or if there is no bandish, if there's just ala going on in the time cycle, I think he's trying to create something that he has never created before. He's tackling something that he has not tackled something before. Maybe in the initial stages, he may have tackled those phrases or those combinations before, but what happens after that? For most great vocalists, they haven't come out with that before. So it's a matter of giving that respect. It's a matter of not only giving that respect, being with that music, being in the moment. And for a tabla player, as an accompanist, if he is in that moment with that artist, I think he will, in full surrender and with full support, then automatically he will realize what to do, what not to do, how much to do, when to do. These are questions which a really good accompanist needs to answer at every stage of the performance, so that he doesn't disturb the artist. So that should be the prime primary state of mind of a tabla player, is not to disturb the artist. And so when to play, what to play, how much to play, these questions need to be answered. Basically, he needs to be, in that moment, he needs to be connected with the music of the artist. And in that recording where Zakir Bhai has played with Malik Arjunji, you can feel that. And because he is connected for so much time playing theka, and then suddenly Malik Arjunji realizes that, "Are, I think Ustad Zakir Hussain is playing with me." Then he says, "Haan, bajao, bajao, bajao." I think in the middle he has said that. So he realizes that connection, that Zakir Bhai is there, he is playing theka, he's been playing for such a, what should I say, dynamic, powerful tabla player, you know, a lion who's kept quiet for so much time. So, you know, he needs his moment to express himself. So he says, "Arre, bajao, bajao." So that's very interesting. It's a very interesting part of the performance. Vocalists who know this subject, who respect this subject, I would say it works both ways. For a tabla player to give that respect, to show that maturity, to show that involvement, to show that connection, I think the vocalist or the instrumentalist also needs to respect that. And whenever there is an appropriate moment, should allow the tabla player to express himself. And that is how it all kicked off with Abbaji and Ravi Shankarji, Pandit Ravi Shankarji. In that process of discovery, it's been my fortune to have been observing Zakir Bhai from a very tender age of 9. And, you know, to see his, to observe his growth in music. I mean, he was always, to me as a kid, he was always an evolved tabla player. So he was probably always 15-20 years ahead of his times, if I may say that. Simply because Abbaji was, in his thought process. So obviously that got rubbed off, it got transmitted. And this whole idea of trying to find out what you can do with the information that you have, the possibilities, I would say this is Abbaji's biggest contribution to tabla, is not how much he gave us. Yes, he gave us a lot. But what are the possibilities with what you have got and what you can do and what you can explore? As they say, nazar. The the keen eyesight or drishti into what you can create and how you can create and how you can go about creating those formulae, how to use those formulae, how to expand your vision. Being rooted to the tradition, not just doing anything from the top of your head. Logical, musical, aesthetic. These things, this is the biggest contribution of Ustad Alla Rakha Khan Sahab. Even people like Pandit Suresh Talwalkarji acknowledge this. This is the biggest contribution of a great tabla player to the tradition of tabla. And so I saw Zakir Bhai always in this mode. You know, in times when tabla was being, I would say, great maestros happened to this instrument. Huge, towering, creative people. But when I saw Zakir Bhai from a tender age, I used to always think that for him, there are still more possibilities to be explored. Right? So, I always saw him exploring new things, exploring new technique, new sounds. And I always saw him as a huge risk taker, never being afraid of taking risks and never being afraid of trying new things. Okay, if they didn't work, that's fine. At least we know that it doesn't work. How will you know that something doesn't work unless you try it, right? So, one day I asked him, I said, how do you jump into this no man's land every time when you perform? I asked him. I said, I want to know this. So he said, you know, obviously primarily Abbaji is my inspiration for that. But the another person who told me point blank looking into my eye was Ustad Ali Akbar Khan. So he said, after one performance, after several performances, Ali Akbar Khan was a very quiet, introvert person. And he said, I wanted to know how I played, how I'm doing, you know, how I'm thinking, how I'm approaching, and what more needs to be done. There's no feedback, you know. So one fine day I went to his place and I said, I want to know, please tell me. So he said, you know, when you play with me, it's fabulous. But in that many time cycles that you have explored and expanded everything, if you can condense that within 3 or 4 time cycles and tell me the same story within a nutshell, I think that day you will be an evolved tabla player. So he, you know, Zakir Bhai narrates this story many times. So he said that rang a huge bell, you know, inside him. And that is when he started looking at it in that way. And he said, you shouldn't be afraid of taking risks and taking the plunge into no man's land. Because if you don't, you'll always keep yourself insular. In that zone where you know, all that, you know, Guru has given you, you're playing the same things, you know, you're going round and round in that area, which is a, you know, pretty thing to do, you know, comfortable zone. But you're not stepping out and trying to see what the outside world is like, outside the world of what your Ustad has given you. And he said that is the true meaning of exploring art, and that's what the great Ustads have done from generation to generation, and that's why we've got all these things, because everyone thought differently and tried to think differently. So that's, I've always seen him in that zone and with such tremendous intensity that intensity took him 10, 15, maybe 20 years ahead of you know, musicians, many musicians of his generation. That's how I've seen him. You know, at 25 years ago, I have heard him play with El Shankar, the great violinist, the great maestro El Shankar, in 9 1/4 beats, where I couldn't even keep 9 properly in my head. I heard him play 9 1/4. So, I mean, times when tabla players of that generation were trying to still explore teen taal or maybe jhaptaal after that. Things like this were going on. And for me, it was mind-boggling. It was a serious education, you know, intense, PhD level for me. Something which I always wanted to, you know. So I'm fortunate to have been exposed to such high level of creativity from such close quarters at a very tender age. And I think Abbaji gave me invaluable and priceless stuff. But what I learned just observing this great man is like a chapter of education in my life separately. You know, I could write a volume on that. Just by observing his performances, whenever I could interact with him, whatever I could extract from there, you know, seeing his creativity, watching his solos. Because Abbaji had taken me to that level where I could learn just by observing him. So I saw him as an innovator. I saw him as a tremendous dynamic musician, a huge risk taker in terms of concepts performing in his performances. So he used to jump and take the plunge. Times when he sat on the stage and he said, if not teen taal, then which taal? Any taal, so chalo. So you know, things like that, things which we never encountered before. Always plan things, what you are going to play, how you are going to go about it, at least the skeleton, and then try to think about improvisation at every stage and things like that. That's how we approached it. Here we see a person who doesn't know even what the skeleton is. He just creates everything right there. So, phenomenal. Yeah, that's how I saw him. Indian classical music is there. Yes, it's been evolving for hundreds and thousands of years. But then there are other musical traditions also that have been evolving over several hundred years, I guess. There's, you know, Chinese classical music, there is Indonesian gamelan, there is, you know, several folk traditions of various countries. I visited South Africa, Japan. I saw Japanese classical music, which is very, very ancient, you know. So then along with that, I saw Abbaji collaborating with so many musicians. So many drummers here, and I mean, I heard him talking about them, his collaborations with, you know, Dave Brubeck and Mickey Hart, and in those days. So I used to wonder, you know, this man who is when he's sitting down on his tabla, he seems like this is his subject. And then he can do something with sitting alongside Mickey Hart. How is this possible? So, when it taught me a huge lesson that, you know, music is limitless. There are infinite possibilities. But the biggest lesson is that he did all that, but he never disconnected himself from his roots, from the tradition. He always remained in, you know, tradition, and therefore musicians who collaborated with him, right, at the end of that collaboration, it was an experience for them, a learning experience for them as well, you know, his thought process. And what you see today, you see drummers in this country, they are trying to play compositions, they are trying to play, you know, the chakradars and tukdas and, you know, corves from the Carnatic style, you know. So these were seeds that were sown by Abbaji, that Zakir Bhai explored to the greatest height possible. And the outcome is this. Yeah, it gave me an insight into, you know, collaborative music. If you have to do it, then what should be the philosophy behind it? and how to do it. Not just get onto the stage and do some mishmash or anything like that, you know, just get a bunch of musicians together and do some, create a band, because it's band culture in the 21st century, you know. But that's not what he taught us. He taught us respect for the tradition, know the tradition, try and understand the values of that tradition, and then collaborate. The outcome from that will be much more meaningful than just getting into something last minute. In our tradition, whether it is music, whether it is spirituality, a guru is always present with you for a temporary period, physically. But the guru shakti is always there. And that has been it's a unique example in our Indian tradition, in our cultural heritage, that whatever has evolved through the guru shakti. It may be inspiration, it may be an idea striking you, it may be something that comes to your mind, you know. It can't happen without guru shakti. Guru shakti can descend and strike you if you have that sense of surrender and dedication. That is also a unique quality in our heritage. So, yes, guru is there to guide you physically, take you through the, right from the teething period to, you know, you evolve as a musician. But then the guru wants you to be an independent thinker and evolve by yourself and find your path. And that's why Abbaji always told us that, you know, you play what I have taught you, you have played. He used to tell Zakir Bhai, but don't sound like me. Everyone will know that I have taught you. My talim will be seen. But my talim should be seen and heard in your own sound, with your own identity. And so, how does that come? That comes by eventually when you tap into the talim that you have got from your guru. The philosophy behind his thought process, all that you have imbibed inside you. And then on those lines you think yourself and you try and create yourself, and maybe like a banyan tree, just the main source is your Ustad and your Guru, but then you're just hanging off as a branch on the other side, trying to, you know, be a part of that tree, you know. Our tradition teaches that first you learn, then you try to master it, and then when you intellectually start becoming independent with the permission of your guru, then you must get into a state of sadhana, which is a constant intense intellectual process of thinking. And that is the state I saw Abbaji in always. And so he was it's like a nuclear reactor all the time, you know. You went and touched him and something would come out, because he was always ready with something. So that process was on. And sadhana eventually takes you into that zone where you are guided by the guru shakti always, in spite of the guru not being there physically. I may have practiced and rehearsed the same things over and over again for the first 7 to 10 years of my life. And then when I used to observe, as I said earlier, I observed my guru, I observed Zakir Bhai, the way they used to take the plunge into the unknown zone. So, I need to do this. Otherwise, if I play the same composition, it's going to sound the same. Right. So if I play the same kaida and improvise it, it's going to sound the same. I need to try and find a way where I can see or improvise the same composition from another angle, and I should be able to do it, I should be able to negotiate it, and I should be able to do it logically and aesthetically, not haphazardly, you know. So what is that logic, and what and how do you maintain the aesthetics, and therefore sit down and break it down, you know, see what the possibilities are, and see if I have to select a certain possibility, how do I go about negotiating it on the spot, in terms of on the spot creation and improvisation. That is something which I, you know, rammed my head on for probably 10-12 years before I actually got down to doing it successfully, you know, reasonably successfully, if I may say so. So it's a process, and it's to be discovered every single day of your riyaz, I would say. Falling back on what your guru has given you in terms of thought process, in terms of formulae, in terms of the way he thought about it in his own way. What are the various ways you can, you know, think about it in your own way? So it doesn't happen instantaneously. There are many steps that you go through. There are many times you fall flat, and that's to your advantage, because the next time you know how to remain upright. You find a way of doing that. So whenever I ask Zakir Bhai that whenever you get into this zone, you know, don't you feel that today it may not happen? He says, yeah, I know, it happens. It happens so many times. I have fallen flat and nothing has worked. But he's saying, I'm not afraid of that. Because the next time, it's not going to happen that way. Because I know how to figure things out. He said, that teaches me how to figure things out. That was a revelation to me. So, you know, things like this, inputs like this have brought about a revolution in just simply thought process in tabla. So yeah, I mean, it's a process, and I'm trying to follow it in my own way. In those times where, you know, we never asked questions. We never asked Abbaji questions on, can you teach me this, or how is this figure, can you figure this out for me? You know, you would get, you know, no asking questions. But after 15 years of Talim, all my questions were answered. So it was one of those processes. These days, even before you start Talim, there are questions. How do you figure this out? Can you teach me this? Can you teach me that? Things like that. So, yeah, so it was very interesting. And as I said, through the process, the Rasa Shastra, or be it Rasa Shastra, be it the Shastra of Tabla, which Abbaji never read any book, but from whatever he's taught me and whatever I have practiced and tried to, you know, make, you know, take it into my subconscious, I have learned so much theory, I have discovered so much, you know, so there are oceans and oceans of knowledge in front of me even today, which are yet to be discovered.